money demon. After 3 days, however, there came the story of the ship's crew in addition to this. Great events. 143. Uneasiness amended ale. The people say that the devil had taken Zarathustra. His disciples laughed, sure enough, at this talk, and one of them said even, and thought, sooner would I believe that Zarathustra hath taken the devil, and thought, but at the bottom of their hearts they were all full of anxiety and longing. So their joy was great when on the fifth day Zarathustra appeared amongst them. And this is the account of Zarathustra's interview with the fire dog. The earth, said he, hath a skin, and this skin hath diseases. My opinion. One of those diseases, for example, is called enquad, man, and quad, and another of these diseases is called enquad, the fire dog enquad. Concerning him men have greatly deceived themselves, and let themselves be deceived. To fathom this mystery did I go o'er the sea, and I have seen the truth naked, verily, barefooted up to the neck. Now that I know how it is concerning the fire dog, and likewise concerning all the spouting and subversive devils, of which not only old women are afraid, and squat up with me, fire dog, out of thy depth, and squat, cried I, and squat, and confess how deep that this is. Whence cometh the which thou snortest up? Thou drinkest copiously of the sea, that did thine and the teared elephants betray. In sooth, for a dog of the depth, thou talkest thy nourishment too much from the surface. At the most, I regard thee as the ventriloquist of the earth, and ever, when one of earth's aversive and spouting devils speak, I have found them like thee, embittered, mendacious, and shallow. Ye understand how to roar and obscure with ashes. Ye are three best braggers, and have sufficiently learned the art of mockery. Ye drag soil. 144. Thus spake Zarathustra. Here I are, there must always be dregs at hand, and much that is spongy, hollow, and compressed, if wanted to have freedom. Freedom we all yearn most eagerly, but I have unlearned the belief in great events when there is much roaring and smoke about them. And believe me, friend Hullabaloo, the greatest events are not our noisiest, but our stillest hours. Not around the inventors of new noise, but around the inventors of new value, that the world revolves, he and audibly revolves. And just don't this. Little had ever taken place when thy noise and smoke passed away. What, if a city did become a mummy, and a statue lay in the mud? And this do I say also to the o'erthrowers of statues. It is certainly the greatest folly to throw salt into the sea, and statues into the mud. In the mud of your contempt lay the statue, but it is just as wrong, that out of contempt, its life and living beauty grow again. With the minor features that have now arrived, solution by its suffering, and barely, it will yet thank you for overthrowing it, like the murder. Answered I, and thought, that is a kind of state, and indeed, However, as he was quiet, I said laughingly, "And Quan, thou art angry, fire dog. So I am in the right about thee, and that I may also maintain the right. Hear the story of another fire dog, who speaketh actually out of the heart of the earth. Hold his breath exhale, and cold and rain, so did his heart desire. What are ashes and smoke nine hot dregs to him? Laughter flitteth from him like a variegated cloud, adverse is. He to thy gargling and spewing and drips in the bowels. The gold, however, and the laughter these doth he take out of the heart of the earth, for that thou mayest know it. The heart of the earth is of gold." And Quoth, when the fire dog heard this, he could no longer endure to listen to me. Abashed did he draw in his tail, said in Quoth, "Bow wow." And Quoth, in a cow's voice, and pressed down into his cave, thus told Zarathustra. His disciples, however, hardly listened to him. So great was their eagerness to tell him about the sailors, the rabbits, and the flying man. "Am I to think of this?" "And Quoth," said Zarathustra. "And Quoth, am I indeed?" "And Quoth, what? A ghost, but it may have been my shadow. You have easily heard something of the wanderer and his shadow." 1-46. Thus spake Zarathustra. "One thing, however, is certain. I must keep a tighter hold of it, otherwise it will spoil my reputation." And Quoth, and once more Zarathustra shook his head and wondered. And Quoth, "What? Am I to think of this?" And Quoth, said he once more. And Quoth, "Why did the ghost cry, 'It is time'? It is the highest time. For what is it then the highest time?" And why? IHU spake Zarathustra. 41. The soothsayer. "And I saw a great sadness come over mankind, the best turned weary of their works. A doctrine appeared, a faith ran beside it. All is empty, all is alike, all hath been. And from all hills there re-echoed, all is empty, all is alike, all hath been. To be sure we have harvested, but why have all our fruits become rotten and brown? What was it fell last night from the evil moon? In vain was all our labor, poison hath our wine become. Evil eye hath sent yellow our fields and hearts. Arid have we all become, and fire falling upon us, then do we turn dust like ashes. Yea, the fire itself have we made. Weary, all our fountains have dried up, even the sea hath receded. All the ground crieth to gape, but the depth will not swallow. Alas! Where is there still a sea in which one could be drowned? So sound he be our plaint across shallow swamps. The soothsayer. 147. Verily, even for dying have we become too weary. Now do we keep awake and live on in sepulchres, and quod. Thus did Zarathustra hear a soothsayer speak, and the carrot orbotting touched his heart and transformed him. Sorrowfully did he go about him wearily, and he became like unto those of whom the soothsayer had spoken. Verily, said he unto his disciples, "A little while, and there cometh the long twilight. Alas, how shall I preserve my life through this, that it may not smother in this sorrowfulness? To remoter worlds shall it be light, and also to remotest nights." Thus did Zarathustra go about grief in his heart, and for 3 days he did not take any meat or drink. He had watching and waited anxiously to see if he would awake and speak again and recover from his affliction. And this is the discourse that Zarathustra spake when he awoke. His home, however, came unto his disciples as from afar. Here, I pray you, the dream that I dream, my friend, and help me to divine its meaning. For little is it still unto me, this dream, the meaning is hidden. In it am engaged, and did not yet fly above it on free pinions. All life had I renounced, so I dreamed. Night watchman and great guardian had I become, aloft, in the lone mountain fortress of death. Where did I guard his coffin, full stood the musky vaults of those trophies of victory. Out in glass coffins did vanquished life gaze upon me. The odor of dust-covered eternities did I breathe, sultry. Thus spake Zarathustra, 148. In dust-covered lay my soul, and who could have dared his soul there? Brightness of midnight is ever around me, lonesomeness towered beside her, and as a bird, death rattles stillness, the worst of my female friends. These did I carry, the nastiest of all keys, and I knew how to open with them the most creaking of all gates. Like a bitterly angry croaking ran the sound through the long corridors when the leaves of the gate opened. Unrecusely did this bird cry, unwillingly was it awakened. But more bright there even, and more heart-strangling was it. When it again became silent and still all around, and I alone sat in that malignant silence. Thus did time pass with me, and slip by, if time there still was, what do I know thereof? But at last there happened that, which awoke me. Thrice did there peal peals of the gate light thunders, thrice did the vaults resound and howl again, then did I go to the gate. Alba, cried I, we carry us as ashes unto the mountain. Alba, Alba, who carrieth the ashes unto the mountain? And I pressed the key, and pulled at the gate, and exerted myself. But not a finger's breadth was it yet open. Then did the roaring wind tear the folds apart, whistling, whizzing, and piercing, it threw unto me a black coffin. And in the roaring and whistling and whizzing, the propion burst open, and spouted out a thousand peals of laughter, and a thousand caricatures of children, angels, owls, blues, and child-sized butterflies laughed and mocked, and roared at me fearfully was I terrified thereby, it prostrated me, and I cried with horror as I neighbor cried before. The soothsayer, 149. light source green. But if thou awokest from them and earnest to thyself, so shall they awaken from themselves and come unto thee. And quoth, thus spake the disciple, and all the others then thronged. 150. Thus spake Zarathustra. Around Zarathustra, grasped him by the hand, and tried to persuade him to leave the bed and his sadness, and return unto them. Zarathustra, however, sat upright on his couch, with an absent look. Like one returning from long foreign sojourn, he looked on his disciples, and examined their features, but still he knew them not. When, however, they raised him, and said, him upon his feet, behold, all on a sudden his eye changed. He understood everything that had happened, stroked his beard, and said with a strong voice, and quoth, well, this hath just this time, and see to it, my disciples, that we have a good repast, and without delay. Thus do I mean to make amends for bad dreams. The soothsayer, however, shall even bring to my side, and verily, I will yet show him a sea in which NTR can drown himself, and fly. Thus spake Zarathustra. Then did he gaze long into the face of the disciple who had been the dream interpreter, and shook his head. God, redemption. When Zarathustra went one day over the great bridge, then did the cripples and beggars surround him, and a hunchback spake thus unto him, and quoth, behold, Zarathustra. Even the people learn from thee, and acquire faith in thy teaching, but for them to believe fully in thee, one thing is still needful: thou must first of all convince us cripples. Here hast thou now a fine selection, and verily, end. Redemption. Opportunity with more than one forelock. The blind canst thou heal, and make the lame run, and from him who hath too much behind, wouldst thou well, also, take away a little. That, I think, would be the right method to make the cripples. Believe in Zarathustra, and quoth, stay. Zarathustra, however, answered thus unto him, so. When one taketh his hump from a hunchback,